the French and Indian War, the history and legacy of the conflict between French and British colonies in North America. Written by Charles River Editors. Narrated by Scott Clem. Introduction. We observe the enemy marching down towards us in three columns. At 10, they formed their line of battle, which was at least 6 deep, having their flanks covered by a thick wood on each side, into which they threw about 3,000 Canadians and Indians, who galled us much. The regulars then marched briskly up to us and gave us their first fire, at about 50 yards distance, which we did not return, as it was General Wolfe's express orders not to fire till they came within 20 yards of us. The British Sergeant Major of General Hopson's Grenadiers describing the Battle of Quebec. On September 13, 1759, a battle was fought on the Plains of Abraham outside the old city of Quebec that was one of the turning point battles in world history. Thanks to the British victory and the events that followed, Canada went from being a colony of France, New France, to being a colony of Great Britain, which permanently changed Canadian history. In many ways, the outcome of the battle brought about several American attempts to seize Canada during the Revolutionary War and War of 1812. And ultimately, it ensured that when Canada became an independent country, it was part of the British Commonwealth with an Anglophone majority and a Francophone minority. Frictions over cultural and political issues between the English Canadians and the Quebecois, dating back to the battle, continue to impact the state of affairs in Canada today. While the battle had a profound impact, it also has been romanticized and mythologized beyond even epic proportions. Though often forgotten today, more than 250 years after the Battle of the Plains of Abraham was the culmination of a long siege, and the decisive action itself was an incredibly short affair at less than half an hour. Despite that brevity, both commanding generals were mortally wounded in the exchange, making British General James Wolfe a national hero on both sides of the Atlantic, and French General Louis-Joseph de Montcalm a convenient scapegoat. Only a few thousand soldiers were engaged on each side, and the battle ended with less than 1,500 casualties combined. Regardless, the French were compelled to quit Quebec after the battle, giving up one of their most important colonial possessions in the New World, and when the fighting ended in North America in 1760, the British still held the city. When the fighting ended on the European continent, the subsequent treaty forced the French to cede most of their North American possessions to the British, and it also left Britain in tough economic straits, which would set about a chain of events that brought about the American Revolution in the following decade. While the Battle of Quebec is no longer famous among Americans, the broader conflict, known as the French and Indian War, certainly remains so. As part of the Seven Years' War, which was being fought between the British and French across the world, the French and Indian War was the last in a long series of colonial conflicts between the two world powers and forever changed the colonial map in America and elsewhere. At the end of the war, disputed North American borders were finally settled, and both empires were left reeling from the cost of war. The war would cement British power in North America and French colonial ambition for decades and bring about a chain reaction that led to the formation of a new nation. The French and Indian War, the history and legacy of the conflict between French and British colonies in North America, profiles the combatants and the political background that led to the war and influenced the American Revolution in the aftermath. In this audiobook, you will learn about the French and Indian War like never before. New France. The French first staked their territorial claim in North America under the realm of King Francis I, starting with the voyage of Giovanni de Verrazzano in 1524 and the voyages of Jacques Cartier in the 1530s. Verrazzano cruised the east coast of what is now the United States and Canada, and a few years later, Cartier made the first of 3 trips to the New World. On his first voyage in 1534, Cartier explored Newfoundland, the Gaspé Peninsula, and the Gulf of St. Lawrence, which he hoped might lead to a northwest passage through the North American landmass to China and its trade riches. During his first trip, Cartier and his men planted a cross on the Gaspé Peninsula, claiming the region for France, but the French had encounters there with the inhabitants already on the land, the Micmacs and the Iroquoians. Cartier returned again the next year, and this time he went up the St. Lawrence, where he visited the Iroquoian villages of Stadacona and Hochelaga, located on the sites of Quebec City and Montreal, respectively. Both are strategic locations on the river, with Quebec at the point where the river narrows with a commanding promontory on the northern bank, and Montreal at the point where the river has a major set of rapids, preventing further ascent without portages. At the request of the king, Cartier made a third voyage to Canada in 1541, but his attempt to plant a colony on the St. Lawrence River with settlers miscarried. Due to violent religious conflicts and power struggles in France between Catholics and Protestants, Huguenots, the French crown was unable to follow up on Cartier's discoveries until the early 17th century. In 1604, the French tried to establish a colony on an island in the St. Croix River, the present-day boundary between Maine and New Brunswick. But that effort lasted only one hard winter. Seeking out a better place, they removed the next year to Port Royal on the Annapolis Basin, a large ocean inlet in what is now Nova Scotia. Attacked by an English force in 1613, this was abandoned and then reoccupied later by the French, to be held onto by the French until another war with the English in 1710. In the meantime, a French settlement farther away from further possible English attacks, and nearer to what was still thought might well be a passage leading to the Orient, was established at Quebec in 1608. Quebec became the capital of New France, and shiploads of French settlers slowly arrived. Small farming settlements spread out along the St. Lawrence River east and west of Quebec as well. The main figure in the successful French colonization of Canada was Samuel de Champlain, who had also participated in the voyages that looked along the Atlantic coast for a suitable French place to settle. In fact, establishing a trading post and settlement at Quebec was his idea, due in part to the fact that by the early 17th century, the Iroquoian village of Stadacona had mysteriously disappeared. Champlain was also the man who made friends with many of the Algonquian-speaking Indian tribes, an important factor that enabled the French to hold on to their colony for as long as they did, by offsetting in wars the advantage in population enjoyed by the English colonies along the eastern seaboard. At the highest point of Quebec overlooking the river, where Champlain had built a fort in 1620, there is now a large bronze statue of him flanked by cannons, honoring his achievements. Quebec remained small during its time as a French possession, existing as little more than a large village, and it had just 8,000 inhabitants at the time of its conquest by the British in 1759. Initially, the settlement occupied a narrow strip next to the river where the port was located, and this lower town was where merchants had their shops and warehouses, particularly for the fur trade in beaver pelts that became New France's economic mainstay. Along with the activities and employment attendant on being a seat of government for the colony, Quebec became a base of missionary efforts by the Jesuits directed at the Indians. An upper town developed with the growth of government and the needs of the church for building space. A Swedish traveler, Peter Kalm, described his impressions of Quebec on his visit in 1749. Quebec lies on the western shore of the River St. Lawrence, close to the water's edge, on a neck of land bounded by that river on the east side and by the River St. Charles on the north side. The mountain on which the town is built rises still higher on the south side, and behind it begin great pastures, and the same mountain likewise extends a good way westward. The city is distinguished into the lower and the upper town. The lower lies on the river, eastward of the upper. The neck of land mentioned before was formed by the dirt and filth which had from time to time been accumulated there, and by a rock which lay that way, not by any gradual diminution of the water. The upper city lies above the other, on a high hill, and takes up 5 or 6 times the space of the lower, though it is not quite so populous. The mountain on which the upper city is situated reaches above the houses of the lower city. Notwithstanding the latter, are 3 or 4 stories high, and the view, from the palace of the lower city, is enough to cause a swimming of the head. There is only one easy way of getting to the upper city, and there part of the mountain has been blown up. This road is very steep, notwithstanding it is made winding and serpentine. However, they go up and down it in carriages and with wagons. All the other roads up the mountain are so steep that it is very difficult to climb to the top of them. Most of the merchants live in the lower city, where the houses are built very close together. The streets in it are narrow, very rugged, and
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.